This is Join Us in France, episode 357. Bonjour, I'm Annie Sargent, and Join Us in France is the podcast where we talk about France. Great places to visit in France, French culture, history, gastronomy, and news related to travel during a pandemic. Today, I bring you a conversation with Elyse Rivin about a few artists connected to the lovely city of Nice on the French Riviera. Today, we'll talk about Matisse, Chagall, Yves Klein, and why they are forever connected to Nice. And of course, the best time to enjoy their work is on a visit to Nice, which I hope you all get to do at some point. If you like what we do here at Join Us in France, take a look at joinusinfrance.com/boutique to check out my cookbook, Join Us at the Table, my Paris tours on the Voice Map app, and my itinerary review service where I help you plan the best vacation in France specifically for you. Follow Addicted to France on Instagram to see the photos I share every week. This week, it'll be photos of Chagall's biblical scenes. For instance, Moses receiving the tablets of the law, Jacob's ladder, the sacrifice of Isaac, and more classic Bible stories as seen by Marc Chagall. They are incredible. You can see them by following Addicted to France on Instagram. The best way to stay in touch with me and with the podcast is to sign up for the newsletter at joinusinfrance.com/newsletter. Bonjour, Elyse.
Bonjour, Annie.
Today we are talking about Nice again.
Again.
But with a twist.
Ooh, with a twist that I love. This is my kind of twist.
Yes, the twist being the artists connected to Nice.
Exactly.
Because like many cities in France, Nice has had lots of artists coming and going and living there and moving there and moving away from there and all sorts of things.
And all sorts of things. And of course, part of that is that the entire Riviera, I never know whether it should be the Riviera, the Côte d'Azur, or the southeast of France, to be honest. I'm not sure.
Or Provence.
Or Provence.
Would be another name for
Provence,
it.
Right. Yeah. But particularly along the coast, actually.
Right. So the Riviera is the coastline.
It's the coastline. Right.
And that's what we call the Côte d'Azur.
The Côte d'Azur.
Because Côte means coast.
Coast, right.
So in French, it's Côte d'Azur. In English, it's Riviera. Yeah. We could say La Riviera in French, but we don't usually say that.
I don't know why it's called the Riviera, to be honest. Do you know?
I do not. I do not.
Interesting. Yeah, but it is, in fact, you're absolutely right, especially since the end of the 19th century, this part of France and the part even more specifically along the coast has been associated with various groups of artists because they discovered the climate there, which was not that fashionable to do before then, number one.
Mm.
And because, like artists earlier at the beginning of the 19th century who went to North Africa, that is, who went to Morocco and Algeria, and they went there because of the light and the color and the differences of the things that inspired them. All of these artists, starting at the end of the 19th century, did the same thing by going to the Côte d'Azur.
Very nice. All right, before we get into the artists, let's talk a little bit about the museum. So we did another episode about Nice.
Right.
A lot of these pieces that they made are displayed in Nice.
In Nice, yes.
And so let's talk about a few of the museums that you shouldn't miss.
Okay, so obviously there are two that are associated specifically with one particular artist, and that is the Matisse Museum, which is in a building called the Villa des Arènes, and it's up on the top of the Simiers Hill, and it's surrounded by a huge park with now an archaeology museum next to it. And I'll talk a little bit about the history of all of that. And that is specifically, of course, the work of Matisse. And then there is a museum called the National Museum of Biblical Art of Chagall.
And that one is amazing.
And that one is down below. And that is very interesting.
Oh, it's on top of the hill as well.
Not as far. Okay.
It's in the same area. Okay. Yeah, it's in the same area.
But notice that the title is of biblical art. And then I'll talk a little bit about what that happened there with that one. But that, of course, is specifically associated with the work of Marc Chagall.
An amazing museum.
For you.
Do not miss it.
This is for you, the best museum.
Yeah.
Not necessarily for me, but there you are.
Yeah, okay. Top of my list.
The top of your list. And then there's a huge, very, very, very good Museum of Modern Art called Maman. Like, Mama, which is the Museum of Modern Art of Nice. So it's an acronym, M-A-M-A-N. And it's a very big and very, very good modern and contemporary art museum. And I insist on saying that because, unfortunately, we have a contemporary and modern art museum here in Toulouse. And I must say, it is not an extraordinary museum. But that I will talk about in a minute about museums and why they're good or not good.
Right.
And then there's the Villa Massena.
Right. So the Maman is in the city center.
It's in the city center.
That one is really easy to get to.
It's a very big and contemporary building, and it's in the city center.
I mean, all of them are easy to get to. There's a very good public transportation system in Nice. But right.
And the Villa Massena is on the Promenade des Anglais.
Yes, it's on.
And the Villa Massena is a museum specifically devoted to art and artists from the moment that Nice became independent, or actually a part of France, that is 1860, to World War One.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very interesting as a focus, and the names of artists I'll mention a little bit later that most people don't know, including me, except that I looked up some of their work. But it's very interesting because it's more connected to a specific kind of art.
Right. Okay. And there are a few other smaller museums, as well as a photography museum in Nice and stuff like that.
And galleries, too.
Galleries and all and sorts of things. Too. But yeah.
And there's, of course, the archaeology museum and a few other things. There is an Asian art museum, but I did not really focus on those. I focused on museums more about what we would call French artists' museums.
Yeah.
I guess we could say it that way.
Yeah. Yeah. All right.
Okay. So, things I learned and I will share with everybody. Just as a beginning, obviously, the south of France has, of course, been associated, as I mentioned, with artists ever since the end of the 19th century. And just to mention, you know, to as a reference and putting things in perspective, I think most people know that Van Gogh, who painted in a lot of different places, is associated with Arles, even though he actually only spent a short time there. He produced an enormous amount of work. So we do have an association, I think, for people in our minds, Van Gogh and Arles.
Yeah.
And Picasso, who lived most of his life in, he actually started by leaving Spain and going to Paris. But much of his life, he lived in the south of France. And he is very much associated with Antibes and with a town next to it called Valoris. Mm-hmm. And Valoris is where he lived and where he had a ceramic studio. So we have, you know, and then there are other artists who went to a town called Serret, which is in the Pyrenees Orientales, close to the frontier with Spain. Some Spanish artists, Miro and people like that, but others who passed through. So there were various different parts. Collioure, we've mentioned in a podcast that Collioure was associated with certain artists as well. But what happened with Nice is that, since we talked about this a lot in the other podcast, Nice just became a magnet attracting people of all kinds. And among the people that were attracted were artists and musicians and writers because of its climate, because it was so open. I think that's, to me, one of the things about Nice too is that it's because of this opening on the bay like that, there's something about it. It's not one of these little villages which are cute and very nice to visit up in the hills or something. There's something about this openness that I find very, very attractive. And so a lot of artists moved there. But what I did not know is that even when Nice was under the control of or part of the Kingdom of Savoy, which means really going back to the time of the Renaissance, there was a school of Nice. That is the name of the painting school of Nice that had a specific style. And I had never heard of it. And I must say that, not that I know everything about art history, but, you know, that was like, oh, really? Mm-hmm, okay, mm-hmm. That's a new one. And I cannot even mention some of the artists because I really do not know who they were. But it really was the beginning of Nice being a place that artists would refer to. mm-hmm. which is, I think, what makes it interesting to know about. And then at the beginning of the 800s, there was a movement in the area called regional painting. I mean, you could say this is something that happened in a lot of different places. And this was basically the second time there was a kind of school of Nice. And these regional artists, many of them are the people you will see in the museum, the Massena Villa, in okay. the Villa Massena. A lot of this is either folk art or it's very pretty landscape painting that's very typical of the area in a more or less romantic or realistic style. I saw some examples online. It's very beautiful work. It's kind of like some of the work you would see in the Orsay Museum, but very specifically artists who lived and worked their entire lives in Nice. Mm. And this probably is also part of the reason why it gave other artists the idea of coming there, because there was really an active movement of artists there.
Yeah. Yeah.
So then we can go to talk about some of the mainliners, I guess we could say the headliners. The first one being, of course, Henri Matisse.
Yes.
Matisse was born in 1869. So he was born like 150 years ago, and he died in 1957. Both he and Chagall lived very long, rich lives. Okay? He was originally from Normandy, like many other artists. Normandy seems to be good for giving birth to artists. You know, they don't stay there that long. I mean, it's lovely to have all that milk and cream, but the rain kind of gets to you after a while. You know, you go looking for sun. You know,
yeah.
But he spent the second half of his life in Nice. He had moved around quite a bit before then, as artists did at the time, and he had tried painting in other places, and he had traveled a bit originally in other parts of the south of France. But somewhere in the middle of his life, in fact, in 1917, he started living in the Regina, which is one of those very fancy Belle Epoque hotels, because it was also a time when artists kind of didn't have their own place. It's very interesting. He had a studio there, but he had an apartment where he lived, but he didn't have a place that was his. It's a very strange kind of thing.
They didn't keep an apartment or a house or something.
Well, he had an apartment because he had a wife. And then when his wife died, he had another wife or mistress. I mean, he did have women around him basically all his life, even as a very old man. And so did Chagall, by the way. But apparently he was never an owner. I mean, he may have had an apartment, but unlike Picasso, because Matisse was also very successful. I mean, so he obviously had enough money.
Of course.
For whatever reasons, he never was a big property owner, which is very different from Picasso.
Uh-huh.
You know, so he lived in the Regina for a number of years. And then he moved to private apartments in another villa. All of this, of course, near where the Villa des Sargent is, up in the hill in that part of Nice. And finally, he took up studio space in the building that is now called the Villa des Sargent. And he finished his life painting there. And he lived on the top floor. And at the time, the building, which is actually from 1865... the bottom floor, the ground floor at that time, was the old, very funky archaeology museum. It wasn't officially a museum. It was like he was above all these little pieces of pottery that were being dug out of the ruins, which are just next door. And he just had the top floor. But the reason he wanted to be there was because of the view of Nice, of the bay, and of the sea. And he wrote and he said that he'd never seen colors like that before in his life. Mm. And of course, Matisse is a colorist. He's what is considered to be a colorist in terms of what kind of art that he'd do. It's figurative mostly, but it's for him, the most important thing of all was the color.
Get the right color.
Get the color and fantasy color, but saturated, beautiful, intense color, inspired by the light and all of that.
Which, you know, as somebody who's never painted really, it's really hard, especially if you get a color once. How do you get it again? That's really hard, like, you know, because it's mixing stuff.
Well, it's mixing.
It's like chemistry.
It is, except that if you take a good look at much of the work of Matisse, particularly, it's not mixed color. It's one color next to another.
And oh, I see.
So this is not, you know, this is part of the change in the way painters dealt with color starting at the end of the 19th century, is that you no longer simply mix colors. That's why, you know, a lot of the artwork from earlier times, it's darker and almost dingy looking. And it's not just because it's dirty. It's because that's the style that was in, that was what people did. Mm. You know, they mixed colors. You can still mix colors. But in fact, if you take a look at the work of Matisse and a lot of the other artists that he hung out with when he was younger, and these are the artists that were called the Fauve, what they did is that they took pure color and they would juxtapose colors.
Okay.
And that way you get an effect. You get a kind of visual effect, a light effect, and that, of course, is what really became his thing to do.
I see. Okay. You know, well, that's good to know.
And then later on in his life, he started being... Well, he was very, you know, old, and he was in a wheelchair. But like Monet, he had very poor vision at the end of his life, and so he spent the last, I think, 10 years doing what are called the cutouts. And he had an assistant, and what he would do is he would use rollers to paint with these pure colors, blues and reds and yellows, on these massive pieces, and then cut out things like the dancers and things like that. And so it's really solid, flat color, but he would just juxtapose one piece against the other. And the reason that they're that big is because that's what he could see.
Huh, interesting.
So, you know, there's a reason why. Basically, you know, you could say, why did they do that? Well, there's usually a reason. You just have to find out what the reason is, you know. So, of course, what happened was that by the time he was a very old man, they had moved the old archaeological museum to a new building. And this was in the beginning of just about 1950. Mm-hmm. And so his work took up more of the space. And before he died in 1957, before he died, he arranged with the city to leave his work that he had, because a lot of it, of course, is now in museums all over the world, to leave his work to the place where he was living if they turned it into a museum for him.
Ah, okay. Okay.
So the building is now the Matisse Museum. It's called the Villa des Arènes, but it's actually a Matisse Museum. And what you have in it is examples of his work plus examples of his collection. So he, like many of these other artists, either traded or bought, mostly traded artwork with other artists that they knew. And also he bought objects that he would use in some of his paintings. So you have ceramics and objects and sculptures and things like that. And some of it is left in situ. So you see the studio as he used it when he was working.
Interesting.
With the view, this fabulous, absolutely fabulous view over the city. So in 1950... that was when they decided that the city bought the building to make it into the Matisse Museum, specifically, because they were actually going to tear it down. I mean, you know, it's like, oh, yeah, let's build up a new lotissement of little square houses or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
And in 1963, it became officially the Matisse Museum.
1963, so it happened soon after his passing.
Oh, soon after his passing.
Yeah.
It was agreed upon before.
The
contracts were signed. He agreed to leave a good part of his collection, and other people donated some of their works to add to it.
So this is a museum that's exclusive to him, other than pieces maybe that he had from other artists. Okay.
Right. And it gives you, he had, of course, during his lifetime, other studios, but it also, like if you go to the Cézanne studio in Aix-en-Provence, which is a tiny little place anyway, but it gives you an idea of what materials he used when he was working, and also the view that he had over the city.
Well, and I like the one in Aix-en-Provence. Interesting because it is small indeed, but then you can walk where he used to go paint the Montagne, whatever it was called.
Mont-Saint-Victoire.
Saint-Victoire, which he painted a million times.
Which he painted a million times.
Yes. But it's just a short walk up the hill. Walk, you know, maybe 10 minutes or something.
Yeah. Well, talking about that, by the way, the last time I was there, which was 2 years ago, there was a young man there. There's always somebody there to sort of be the guide, but also to make sure you don't touch anything more than anything else. But they were saying that they're trying to buy up the land that's just outside the studio, which is now built up and has lots of trees, but also has a house or two, because what they want to do is tear everything down so that you can see the view that he had from the studio before.
I see.
I'm not sure if they were going to be successful doing that, but it's interesting. Interesting thing to do.
But anyway, that's an annex.
So that's an annex.
We diverge.
Yes. Well, talking about artists and studios in the south of France, and there you are. But what I think is really interesting is that it's not a big museum. Unlike the Chagall Museum, it's relatively small compared to the Chagall Museum, even in physical size, but it really does give you a very nice view of what inspired him, and I like where it is. I think that's also part of what it is. I like.
So is that your favorite one?
Well, I like Matisse a lot, but I don't have a favorite artist. I mean, this is a ridiculous thing to say, but it's like asking me if I had 10 children, which is my favorite child. I mean, these are not my children, but no, I like his work a lot. Uh-huh. And so I really enjoy going there because I like the feel of being in a space where the artist was and the view that
well,
you
definitely,
get.
Since he lived there. I mean,
and he lived there.
Yeah.
And, you know, but Matisse, like Chagall, but probably even more so, is an artist who has work in every major museum in the world.
Oh, yeah.
And he was very prolific. So, I mean, there were even a couple of Matisse here in the Bomberg Foundation, which is also another museum that's closed right now, here in Toulouse.
Before we started recording, we were complaining about how all the museums are closed in Toulouse right now.
Yeah, right. They're all on vacation. They all decided to go
on vacation at the same time.
Yeah. Yes, I do like it anyway. So, and then, of course, the other museum that is devoted specifically to the work of one specific artist is this National Museum of Biblical Art for Marc Chagall.
My favorite.
And, of course, Marc Chagall is someone who's very interesting because he was Russian. He was born in Russia. And doing a little bit of research on his background, I knew some things about him, but I wasn't aware of the fact that... He was born in Russia in 1887. He's just basically one generation younger than Matisse, okay? And he, so he lived, and he was, I think, 93 when he died. So they both lived very long, full lives. So he was born in Russia, and he came from a very interesting background. He came from a very religious Hasidic Jewish family,
right,
where painting is forbidden.
Really?
Figurative painting is forbidden.
Oh.
And it's very interesting, the story of how he became an artist, is that he was the youngest of a slew of children, and he was apparently adored by his mom, and he was very gifted, and as a child was drawing things and showed so much gift that in spite of the fact that there really is in a really religious family like that, you're not supposed to do figurative artwork. This is very similar to Muslim ideas about, you know, art, ancient Muslim ideas. Yeah. You don't do figurative art. Don't even ask me to explain why. But because
you can't represent.
You can't represent
God,
things.
But God's creations.
But God's creations, exactly. So animals and people and...
Right.
But, you know, even houses. I mean, whatever. You're not supposed to do figurative art. But because he was so gifted, they made an exception. And they allowed him to actually go to art school. And he left. He was born in a town in Belarus, which is part of the Russian Empire at the time. And so he went off to art school. And this is a man who literally was a success from the very beginning. He never had to struggle to become recognized as an artist. And what he did do, which is what makes his work interesting, because it is, of course, basically what he continued to do all his life, is that he used his background as inspiration for his work. So in many of his paintings, you see what basically are typical villages of the kind of, that he grew up in, and the people dressed it that way. And then, of course, it becomes very fantastical because he was involved in the Surrealist movement and all of that. So people are flying in the sky, and you have violinists who are, you know, I mean, the bride, and it's, you know, all of that kind of stuff. But because he was so good, not only did he manage to get to art school, but he actually started working as an artist in Russia. And then because, as an artist, he was the student of a man whose work I know because I actually had to study his work, a man named Leon Bakst, who was a very interesting artist who did mostly engravings and things like that. But he knew about Paris and he knew about the Parisian artists. And so his dream was to go to Paris and to go to France. And so, in fact, he did. And so he arrived in Paris and was working in Paris. And then in 1914, he actually went back to Russia.
Okay.
And he went back to Russia because it's the beginning of World War I.
Yes.
But what I did not know was that he stayed in Russia again until 1922.
Oh, that was a long stint, yeah.
It was a long stint. And he became a professor and a well-known artist in Russia during that time.
Uh-huh.
So there was a real period where he was back to his Russian identity, you know. And then in 1922, he moved back to France, which is where he wanted to be. And he loved France. Now, of course, at this point, he was not in Nice. He was in the northern part of France.
Mm-hmm.
But he
probably in Paris.
He was probably in Paris. I think he traveled around a bit. He went to the south, and he went to Normandy, and he met up with a lot of other artists. And it was only in the 1930s that he asked to become a citizen. And in 1931, he asked to actually become a French citizen, and he became a French citizen in 1937, and never went back to Russia.
That took a long time.
It took a long time.
We complain about citizenship applications taking a long time right
That's
now.
That's right. No, it's true. It's true.
Yeah.
It's very interesting. And then, of course, what happened very sadly was that because of the rise of Hitler and the Nazis, when it looked like France was going to be occupied, he was able to leave because he was well known and he had people in the United States who helped him.
Mm-hmm.
And so he left and he spent all of the years of World War II up till 1948 in the United States.
Mm.
And in 1948, he returned to France and moved to Saint-Paul-de-Vence, which is the gorgeous village in the hills right above Nice.
Yeah.
And he spent the rest of his life there.
I see.
So that is when he started to be really associated with Nice and that
Provence.
Yeah. And he is buried there, which I hadn't realized. He's actually buried in Saint-Paul-de-Vence. Now, he didn't live in Nice, but this is a man who was really world famous. And of course, a lot of his work was already being shown in Nice, and he was meeting all these other artists. And in 1970, the Minister of Culture, André Malraux, who was a man very, very important in terms of the recognition of contemporary artists and making lots of new museums and things like that. He knew him. They were friends, actually. Mm-hmm. And he went to him. Now, he's already an old man, right? And he went to him and he said, "We would like to make a national museum of your artwork."
Mm.
And so they had apparently a long discussion, and Chagall agreed to give 17 of his biblical-themed paintings as a starter to this museum. And the museum is therefore based around these 17 biblical-themed paintings, because this is what happened to Chagall. And this is what's interesting. With the background that he had, the kind of family he came from, what happened was that starting in 1959, somebody asked him if he would do stained glass windows in a church. Now, he was not even Christian, of course, but he believed that the future of mankind was reconciliation, mm-hmm. and reconciliation of people of the different faiths and different cultures and things like that. So in 1959, he did his very first stained glass windows for the Cathedral of Saint-Étienne in Metz.
Mm.
And from that point on, he became known as the artist not only who did paintings, but who did stained glass windows.
Mm-hmm.
And so he did many, many churches and chapels all over France.
Right.
And this became almost a second career for him. It wasn't just his paintings that he did. And so little by little, he became known as a biblical artist, which is kind of interesting when you think about it.
I'm assuming that as a religious Jew, he probably was based in a lot of these stories from the Old Testament.
From the Old Testament.
Right. And you can tell, I mean, as someone who's read the Old Testament, I recognize the stories.
Right.
And they are pretty fantastical, the way he makes them.
Well, yes, of course.
You know, it's like, whoa, okay, what's happening in this one? I've read the story, and when I was there, and the signage is very good because they do tell the story of the Bible.
Of the Bible.
On the signs. And so you can have a refresher, you know, right. What the story is. And I thought it was lovely. I thought it was just really interesting as, I mean, you know, the Bible is reportedly the most read book of all times.
Of all times, right.
Now, I don't know that so many people, some of the people who talk about it the most should read it a little more carefully.
Right.
But it's really interesting to see this art that he produced based on sometimes not very well-known Bible stories.
Right.
You know,
right.
These are not all the Bible stories that you would tell your kids if that's something you do. So, I thought it was wonderful. I thought it was and it's in a beautiful location.
It's in a beautiful location. I would say, I would venture to say, I mean, aside from people either like or don't like this style of his painting, you mm-hmm. know, it's based really on surrealism, which is something that influenced me enormously. And surrealism is really the idea that you use your dreams and the kind of non-rational imagery that you can develop in your brain to talk about things, you know. So it's a combination of that and folklore, which comes out of his childhood and his background, of course. And of course, it's all figurative work, you know. It's just that it's just fantastical in a certain kind of way. But it's never fantastical in a way that people don't understand.
No, but that's one of the that's part of the charm is you go and those things, you wonder what they are. Like you spend a lot of time. You know, sometimes you look at a piece of art and it's just like my brain is not engaged.
Right.
You can't do that with Chagall.
No.
It's really engaging in a way like, what is this? And what is it doing there?
Right.
And what's this person doing at that point?
Right.
Whatever. You know, it's just really, ça interpelle. I don't know how to say that in English. It's like it's asking you questions.
Right. It reaches out to you in some way.
Yes, in some way. And not just because it's beautiful, because it is, but sometimes it's a bit... Like the drawings are a bit basic. Like some of it, it's something I imagine I could do, but I wouldn't have the thought to put those
elements together.
Right. Yeah. And I think we should mention that another major piece of his is, of course, the ceiling of the Palais Garnier in Paris,
right.
Which is also that kind of fantastical, but around the theme of opera.
So
he made different panels about different famous operas.
Which was
really good at that.
And which is really similar to the kind of scope of things he did with the stained glass windows, which are pretty much everywhere, you know. I mean, there's a scope to it. The thing about his work that makes it interesting is that it takes... As you say, stories from the Bible or stories that you think you know, but it gives them a twist somehow, you know.
Yeah.
There was a wonderful, I'm making it aside, but I think it's really interesting because it's very much connected to his work. A Nobel Prize winning writer, Isaac Besseves Singer, who spent the first half of his life in a Jewish village in Eastern Europe and then went to New York and lived the rest of his life there. He wrote books that describe the things you see in Chagall's paintings. That's the only way I can put it. His books are wonderful. I've read several of them. And they all take place in this world that is the world you could imagine walking into if you walk into one of Chagall's paintings.
What's the name of the author?
Isaac B. Singer.
Singer.
Singer. And he is a Nobel Prize winning literature.
Did he write?
He wrote in first in Yiddish and then in English.
I think I've read some of his books. The story of that boy in New York.
He did
The Chosen.
That's Potok. That's Potok.
That's Potok. Okay, sorry.
No, that's Chaim Potok. But his later works take place in New York, but his earlier books are the ones that I find wonderful because they take place in this place and time that literally comes out of a Marc Chagall painting.
So he wrote the books after Chagall did his work.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. You
know. Another thing that's really interesting about the Chagall Museum is that one of the rooms is a performance room with... it has some of his stained glass windows.
Yes.
And a beautiful stage. There was a grand piano when we visited. I think it's probably a performance room that maybe 250 people max. Mm-hmm. It's not a large performance room. I would love to go attend a concert in there.
Because with background.
With the windows. It was gorgeous. It was just gorgeous. And when I do the illustrations for the episode, I think I'm mostly going to use photos of the Chagall Museum because I loved it so much more than all the other ones.
No. You have to include the others. That's not fair. That's not fair. Either that,
I don't know if I took them.
There you are. Anyway, to know that it was in 1973 that the museum was inaugurated. Mm-hmm. And after it was inaugurated, Chagall decided to leave 10 more paintings to the museum. And all the drawings and watercolors associated with all of these works. Mm-hmm. And since then, what has happened is that the museum has acquired other paintings. And so this is actually considered to be one of the largest collections of his work in one place anywhere in the world.
Yeah.
And of course...
Yeah, there's a lot.
There's a lot of work. Now, again, his work is really in almost every major museum everywhere in the world. But since he lived to be almost 100, he was able to produce enough work that he could fill up all these places without any trouble, you know.
Yeah.
So, interestingly enough, both of these artists lived to see the museums that were in their name, which is kind of nice.
Yeah.
So I'd like to also talk about other artists, just mentioning two that I specifically know a lot about, but that I think are interesting that you would not like, at least certainly one you would certainly not like, but it doesn't matter. But because after this, I mean, both artists basically ended their lives in the middle of the 20th century. I mean, after living very, very long, full lives. But there is now and has been since post-World War II a very, very big important art scene in and around Nice that has to do more with abstract painting and post-World War II art. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of these artists are in this Museum of Modern Art in Nice, a lot of them. It's a huge museum. It's an actually incredible museum. But there are two artists very specifically because both of them lived their lives in Nice and are actually very famous in France and a little bit outside of France. And one of them, his name was Yves Klein. I just saw a few years ago a retrospective of his work at the Pompidou Center in Paris. He's really very famous. He was born in Nice in 1928. Both of these artists, unfortunately, strangely enough, for totally different reasons, did not live very long lives. But he was born in 1928, and he was a multimedia artist. That is, he did video, he did painting, he did sculpture, he did experimental work, very, very experimental work, that was really what could be called cutting edge, because he basically did it before almost anybody else did. But what he is most famous for now, and there are several of his big works in this Museum of Modern and Contemporary Art in Nice, is he, and this is possible to do, which is really kind of strange, he invented a blue, a color. He actually invented a color. He created his own mix, which of course is something the old artists from centuries ago used to do, that has come to be called and is actually literally copyrighted, called Klein Blue.
I see.
And it's this extremely, extremely intense blue. There's no way of describing it. You can see pictures of it. He used it to do either monochromes or paintings that had a lot of texture but was abstract because he was influenced by Asian and Oriental thinking and meditation. And he believed that the idea of contemplation, specifically of the color blue, was something that would calm the soul. It's very interesting. I mean, he did a lot of these very strange, weird things.
Maybe it would.
In any event.
Never tried.
He is very, very famous. And he was the influence for many, many other artists who have come since then. He died of a heart attack at the age of 34. Mm. He was in the process of doing a series of works. And he literally, in the midst of filming something that he keeled over at the age of 34 and died.
That's terrible.
But he was born and raised and lived most of his life in Nice. And so he is very much associated with the school of what's called the second school or post-World War II school of Nice. And a lot of his work is in the Maman. And the other artist, an artist that I actually do like a lot is an artist who was also born in Russia, whose background is nothing like Chagall's. His name was Nicolas de Staël, and he was a little bit older. He was born in 1914, and he was actually from an aristocratic Russian family that had to flee Russia because of the revolution. Mm-hmm. And they came and settled in Nice, like many, many of the Russian immigrants did. And so he grew up in Nice.
Okay.
And he was a painter who did paintings that are abstract, but basically based on landscape. So when you look at most of them, you really recognize that it is a landscape. It's not pure, just splash of color in a way. But he was influenced by Matisse, particularly, and other artists like Matisse, in using pure color and juxtaposing color one next to the other. And a couple of years ago in Aix-en-Provence, and there's a wonderful small museum there, I saw a retrospective of his work with a good friend of mine, who she is not someone who's really into art necessarily or anything. And both of us loved the show. And he is very famous. And he's very famous because his work is really work that's kind of on the border between figurative and non-figurative, but with these thick strokes of gorgeous color. And it might even have a couple of works that you would enjoy looking at. They're really beautiful. Most of his work is very small, but he was very productive. And he, unfortunately, died at the age of 41, but not of a heart attack. He actually committed suicide.
Oh, dear.
Because a woman left him. So, I mean, there are stories like that.
Well,
it does happen.
Not because the woman left him, because he had issues.
Because he had issues. Yeah. But his work, he was very prolific. His work is really gorgeous. And there's a lot of it also in Nice, but everywhere as well. He's very, very well known as being an artist of the 50s and 60s who was extremely prolific and who really influenced both of these people in different ways, have influenced the two generations of artists who have come since then. There are a couple of other artists that people might want to know about just because their work is associated a little bit with Nice. And one of them is a French artist named Raoul Dufy, D-U-F-Y, who did kind of folkloric, funky, figurative work in a kind of what's called a primitive style. He lived the second half of his life in Nice, and a lot of his work is in major museums everywhere, and you will see some of his work in the museum in Nice as well. And then there are other artists that are more recent. There's one sculptor who's no longer alive named Armand, whose work I honestly don't particularly like, but who really became famous because he took cars and everything that was metallic, and he would crush these things and make them into these funky kind of shapes and forms. And this was at the beginning of the 50s or late 50s and early 60s. And he is the one who created the form for the César, which is the...
I know what that looks like, yeah.
In the States, we have the Oscar, and in France, there's the César.
Yeah, and it's it does look like a crushed
car. It looks like
car.
A crushed thing, right?
Yeah, it does.
So he lived in the hills right above Nice. And a lot of his work is also in this museum. And an artist who's still alive, who's not young at all anymore, and whose work I also like very much, for anybody who's interested in anything that's connected to pop art, but very different from stuff like Andy Warhol. I think he's actually in his 80s now. A man named Martial Reiss, M-R-A-Y-S-S-E. Of course, all this is in the text. Who is still painting, and who has lived and worked in Nice almost all his life. So these are contemporary artists, and basically they were brought there or lived there, but their work was all moved in some way influenced by either Matisse or Chagall because of the kind of style that they use.
Very interesting. So I would say that for a contemporary art museum, I did not hate that one.
Good. We're making progress, Annie.
But I particularly enjoyed going up to the roof, and you get nice views from there.
Right.
That was really cool. But the art, I mean, I took some photos. I know I took some photos. So some of it did not, offend me as much as others. You know, I must be a dinosaur. I don't know.
Well, all I can say is a lot of stuff that's certainly been done in the last, I'd say, 30, 40 years that is very weird that I don't particularly like. But there is stuff that I think you have to understand to be able to appreciate. And otherwise, what I always tell people...
In other words, elitist.
No, I don't think so.
You have to understand it to be able to appreciate.
Do you understand? I don't like a lot of biblical scenes. I find them boring, to be very honest.
And I like them.
And why? Because you understand them.
I've caught you.
Yeah. This is the point, okay? When you take people to a museum, the most important thing is to give them a key to how to look at a work of art, okay? If you take children to a museum... You put them in front of anything. They have no background, yes or no, or why this is good or why it's bad. Ask them if they think something is interesting. They'll give you answers that you would never expect because they're just looking at it just in terms of what they have in front of them. And it may not be what the artist was thinking of when the artist mm-hmm. did it, mm-hmm. but they will find something. Or they will say it's funny, or it's silly, or it's ugly, or it's this, or it's that, or I like the colors or the forms. But there, you know, the problem is that contemporary art, for a lot of people, nobody understands what it's supposed to be about.
Yeah, what the heck is this?
Whereas,
so it's like it becomes invisible after a while because it's like, I don't know what this is. It doesn't talk to me. It doesn't like.
Yeah. To see a lot of 15th century and 16th century Madonnas, they will be bored to tears because after all, it's a pretty woman with a baby. Okay, I've seen one, I've seen them all, you know. I'm going to make sure I get you. The best example I can give, my blessed mom that I miss so much, she knew nothing about art, nothing. I took her to a contemporary art museum. And we walked around, and I just pointed out different things to her. And then I'd say to her, I'd say this is what this is about. Some of it was painting, some of it was figurative, some of it was not, some of it was actually installation, some of it was photography. And after it was all over, I'd say to her, which of these pieces did you find interesting? And she would blow my mind because she surprised me. And mm-hmm. And because she had no a priori about anything, she just went, that kind of is interesting because, and I think, well, that's something I never thought about before. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So one of these days I'll get you to do that.
No, but I kind of like this one in Nice. I thought it was interesting, you know.
I mean, there's some work that's really fun, and fun is okay in art. And then there's work that's boring, and then there's work that's beautiful, and then there's work that's ugly.
But honestly, if I only had time for one museum,
you'd go to the Chagall.
I'd go to the Chagall, no
of
question.
Course.
You know.
Of course.
Because a lot of other things, it's a matter of what time you have.
Exactly. Everybody, when you go there, give yourselves time to go to all of them.
Yeah.
I have never been to the Villa Messina. I mean, I don't know how much I would enjoy it. But
I have. It was fine. The cat, there was a nice cat in there.
Uh-huh. There you are.
They have a cat that's just the resident cat.
Oh, Annie, she's hopeless. What are we going to do with you?
So I had fun taking photos. I tried to take photos that showed the cat. And the art behind the cat.
Right, right.
But it's like kind of Renaissance type of stuff in there. But it's fine. It's a nice, beautiful building. You go for the building as much as you go for
and
the
it's,
art.
It's very,
you know?
It's art from the beginning of the 1800s, but it's much more in a kind of classical vein.
Yeah.
But, you know, so.
It was a little bit stuffy old French museum, but not too bad.
No.
Not too bad. But the Chagall was outstanding. Go to the Chagall.
Go to Matisse and the Rivin one too.
You know, I am not sure I even went to the Matisse.
You've never been up there?
I've been up that hill, but
you've never been in the museum?
I am not certain. If I did, I don't remember it.
Shame on you.
Merci, Elise.
Bye, Annie.
Au revoir.
Au revoir.
Again, I want to thank my patrons for supporting the show and giving back. Patrons get several exclusive rewards for doing so. You can see them at patreon.com/joinus. Thank you all for supporting the show. Some of you for years. You are wonderful. And a shout out this week to new patrons, Sue Daniel, Brad Mizurk, Susan Atkinson, and Robin Shu. Thank you so much for becoming patrons and making this podcast possible. And thank you, Linda, for upgrading to yearly support. My thanks also to Terry Lidstone for sending in a one-time donation by using the green button on any page on Join Us in France that says Tip Your Guide. Terry wrote, "Merci, Annie and Elyse, for sharing such an intimate perspective on life and traveling in France. We're just finishing a grande randonnée through the Southwest, and your podcasts on Sarlat, Cahors, and Albi have enhanced our experience greatly." Well, bravo to you as well for the grande randonnée. This is hard work, so congrats on doing that long hike. My thanks also to Robert Goodfellow for his generous donation on PayPal. Robert wrote, "Dear Annie, I want to thank you for your work. I listen to your podcasts when I walk my dog, cook, you name it. It's a happy escape for me, and I hope you keep going because your efforts mean so much to so many." Robert. Thank you so much, Robert. I love to listen to podcasts when I do stuff around the house and walk the dog as well. So I'm happy to hear that you're enjoying them. I invited both Terry and Robert to the Addicted to France private community, where I deliver exclusive content for donors and patrons, and where we can chat about France outside of Facebook. You know, many of us, we like to complain about Facebook, so here's your chance to engage your Francophile tendencies outside of Facebook on Addicted to France. And another way to support this podcast is to hire me to be your itinerary consultant. I know you love France and many of you know it well, but if you get stuck on some part of your plan and would like to feedback from a local, go to joinusinfrance.com/boutique to book a session. If you enjoyed this episode, you might want to also listen to episode 345, which is our walking tour of Nice. I just wanted to put that in somewhere. This week, I got an email from Heather, who arrived in Paris last week. Her plan was to stop at an ATM to get an Orange SIM card at the airport and then call an Uber. But on the terminal where she landed, the ATMs were out of cash. This happens a lot. And the Relais store were all closed. Relais stores are, they sell books, magazines, snacks, and SIM cards, among other things. A friendly police officer took her to a store that was open, and the employee put the Orange SIM card in her phone, and she was able to call an Uber. It was early in the morning, and the Uber ride into Paris was a horrid 1 hour and 45 minutes. Her words. Heather made a few mistakes. Clearly, she's in Paris enjoying her vacation now, so it worked out, but arrival could have gone better. Here's how. Most flights from the US and Canada arrive in Paris early in the morning. If you land between 9 and 6 a.m. local time, a lot of stores are going to be closed. Don't plan on buying a SIM card when you land. Get it in advance from the comfort of your home. And if you go to joinusinfrance.com/boutique, then scroll down to Annie's Faves with the Amazon logo, you'll find a lot of goodies I recommend you get before your trip. When you buy through that link, you support the podcast as well, so it's a win-win. If you plan on buying a European SIM card, do it at home, but do not activate the card until the day before your trip or until the day you arrive, because those things, timing matters. The next thing to look at is Uber. Every time I go to Paris, I use Uber. It's great. I have no problem with Uber. The thing is, Uber drivers are not allowed to use bus lanes. So the drive between the airport and Paris during rush hour is always terrible. You have to put up with the belt route traffic, but everyone has to suffer through that. And when you finally enter Paris proper, they cannot take bus lanes. Why do you want the bus lanes? Because they're not full and because lights turn green much faster for buses. If you're in an Uber, you'll be stuck in traffic while taxis get through much faster. I was in an Uber once in Paris, not coming from the airport, but it was an Uber, and he broke the rules and took bus lanes, and taxi drivers were trying to run him off the road, swearing at him, honking at him, etc. Is that how you'd like your drive to go? I don't think so. Don't take Uber between the airport and Paris. Take a taxi instead. Now, if you really love Uber, you have my blessing to use it when you're going back to the airport at the end of your trip, because then rush hour is mostly over. I would still rather go to the nearest taxi stand where I'm staying, because the rate is also set going back to the airport, and there are taxi stands everywhere in Paris. Be strategic when you choose transportation methods. Some people swear by the RER as well. I hate it personally because it's packed and sweaty and there are stairs, and I want none of those things when I'm arriving on a vacation. But some people take the bus that takes you to the opera, near the opera house. It's called Roissy Bus. It works well, especially if your hotel is near the opera house. All of these have pros and cons, but I argue that when landing in Paris from North America, taxis are well worth the price. Taxis to and from the airport apply set rates. You'll pay 53 euros if you're going to the right bank and 58 if you're going to the left bank. It shouldn't break the bank for most of you. I'll post a link in the show notes so you can read the details. And a note about airport ATMs. I've never been able to withdraw small amounts at an airport ATM. Most of them force you to withdraw 500 or something. And since I usually pay for most things with a credit card, there's no need for me to have 500 euros in my pocket. So if you want to withdraw more normal amounts, wait until you're in Paris and use an ATM at a bank. I have a French tip of the week this week. It's kind of a funny one. I want to make you aware of a new expression in French that I've been hearing for the last few years on and off. And you'll hear it if you listen to any French news or pay attention to French politics. The expression is yaka faucon, which is short for il n'y a qu'à, il faucon. This is in the realm of familiar, but not vulgar at all. It's not in the dictionary yet, but give it 10 years and it will be, I think. Let me break it down for you. Il n'y a qu'à, all we have to do is, strung together with il faut qu'on, we have to do this and that. So if you string them together quickly, you get yaka faucon, which can be spelled in a few different ways. It's not really a word yet. And, you know, even though it's a new thing, everybody understands it. French native speakers understand this the second they hear it. Yaka faucon, like, yeah, of course. This is used to mock people who propose solutions that appear simple and effective, but are totally unrealistic. For example, you know, if there are too many traffic jams in your town and the mayor just says, well, people should just stop taking their cars. Yeah, yaka faucon. I'm not sure how to translate that because it's all in the tone. Something like, yeah, tell people to stop taking their car. Why don't you? As if that could ever work. I've heard it in a lot in the news this week because the green candidates had their green... I've heard it in the news a lot this week because green candidates had their primary in anticipation of the presidential election next year. They were all invited on French radio a lot, and there were a lot of yaka faucon exchanges because, let's face it, you know, some of the solutions bandied around are totally unrealistic and will never work. Journalists know it, opponents know it, but you know, they still. Anyway, I heard a lot of yaka faucon this week. It's a gentle put down against anyone who suggests unrealistic and simplistic solutions to complicated problems. This week in French news, well, it's been a quiet week in France. We're slowly vaccinating more and more people. I just looked up the numbers, and they are improving everywhere on the mainland. French Guiana is still an area of concern because they have such low vaccination rates. Come on, Guiana, you can do this. In mainland France, we're just about back to normal, other than needing to wear a mask indoors and showing a health pass to enter restaurants or movie theaters or museums, etc. We're used to it by now. It's not a big deal. Because you need a health pass to be able to sign up for sports, lots of French teens are getting vaccinated this fall. We're up to 73% of teens vaccinated in France, and that number will keep going up because kids want to go back to their soccer club and to going to the movies with friends and all of that. The fuddy-daddies that oppose vaccination are still vociferous, but they are such a small minority that the rest of them can ignore them. I still haven't found a single person who had a vaccination in France and tested positive before their flight home. I'm not saying that this is impossible, but I am saying that it doesn't seem to be happening at all. If you read or hear of a unicorn who tested positive before their flight home and thereby has to stay in France longer than they plan to, please let me know. Another thing that's happening is it looks like the people who are planning to come to France are getting their health pass fairly well. One lady emailed me this week saying how she was really upset because she hadn't received hers, and I tried to give her some tips to find them. But, you know, for one email from one person who says she didn't get hers, I get 10 more people who say, yay, it worked, you know, I'm so happy. So, yeah, it doesn't work for everyone. And unfortunately, we're in a pandemic, but, you know, I wish we weren't. Former French President Sarkozy was found guilty of campaign finance violation for the second time. So this was, he was convicted once, then he appealed. This was the second trial, and he was found guilty again. The sentence, again, is 1 year in prison, but the judge said that he wouldn't have to go to the big house. Will he need to wear an ankle bracelet? This just happened. Things are still up in the air. And he can appeal again. So, but this goes to show you that being the president doesn't exempt you from living within the boundaries of the law, at least not in France. Let's see what happens to him. Don't hold your breath. I don't think he'll be dragged away in shackles or anything like that. I don't know how I feel about that. I mostly lived in the U.S. when Sarkozy was president. I didn't follow his tenure, you know, blow by blow. So I'm looking at all this wondering, is he really a crook, or was he just, did he make a lot of enemies? I'm not sure what it is. Anyway. For my personal update this week, I got my new iPhone. It's very exciting when you get a new iPhone, you know. It doesn't happen that often. It's the iPhone 13 Pro. It is wonderful having normal battery life again. I haven't recorded video yet, but I look forward to trying the shift focus thingy. The photos that I took really pop. I look forward to trying it in a dark environment, like, you know, a darker room or a cathedral. But I've only had it a day, so I haven't had time to do that much with it. I really like that this new iPhone is thicker and more rectangular than my two previous iPhones. I had the 8 Max and the 10. The shape of this one is more like an iPhone 4 or an iPhone SE, and that's what I was looking for. I hope that Apple continues to step away from the super thin phones because they are too easy to bend. When I put my phone in my pocket and I do something as outrageous as sitting down, what was I thinking? Every time you bend the phone just a little bit, you know, just not a lot, just a tiny bit. But we sit down a lot with the phone in our pockets. And by the time I finally said, okay, I've had enough, this phone, the battery doesn't hold the charge anymore properly, they said, well, you could change the battery. So I take it in to a repair shop, and they said, oh, sorry, your phone is bent. And so if I open it, I may not be able to close the case again. I'm like, ah, okay. So stop making such thin phones, Apple, because they bend. I mean, like, they bend in the wind, those things. It's terrible. So I'm excited to see if the iPhone 13 keeps its shape better. It looks good, but time will tell. My husband and I were scheduled to take a couple of weekends away, but there's been work complications, so we're having to postpone. So Rochefort, Cognac, and Périgueux will have to wait for a while, but we'll go. I spent some time at the beach in Villanova and Cubelles with my daughter, and it was absolutely lovely. Our Labradoodle Opie came this time, and that's why we went to Cubelles, which has a doggy beach. Now, I had never been to a doggy beach. It's like a regular beach, but it is all fenced. And it was just a section of beach. And most days when we showed up, there were sometimes just a dog or two, but sometimes there were like as many as 30 dogs. So it was very fun. Now, Opie does not like to swim at all. She came in once, and the tiny little waves, just she was frightened by the waves. And honestly, once she got wet and then was on the sand again, by the time we left the beach, she was like full of sand everywhere. It was terrible. So I was like, oh. So obviously we brushed her. But then the next day I was like, okay, let's not encourage her to go in the water if she doesn't want to, because it's a mess. So we took her to a local groomer before we headed home. She did a fabulous job. I wish I could take that groomer and just take her home with me, because she was really good. And we had a strange experience on the way there. Halfway to Spain, I opened the trunk to give some water to the doggy Opie. And when I went to close my trunk again, it wouldn't latch. I tried everything I could think of. It wasn't working. So I had some string in the car, and I rigged something up the best I could. And we made it safely to Spain. We kept the trunk shut with the string the whole time. The car was empty. So, and it's an old car. It's not like I was worried about somebody stealing the car or anything. But, you know, it's old enough that I think it's time for a new car. But at the same time, I need a tow ball for when I'm doing yard work. I have a trailer, a little trailer for yard work, and also I have a nice thing for my electric bike and my husband's bike, and we need a tow ball. And I just started looking. It looks like hybrid cars don't really come with a tow ball, which, you know, I'll keep looking. It's possible I'm wrong. And also, I'm just a lowly podcaster. I'm not going to spend $50,000 on a car. So that's the other problem I have. So, but it's been a very good week for us, and I'm very glad we went to the beach. It was lovely. Show notes for this episode are on joinusinfrance.com/357, where you can see a recap of what we've discussed, as well as links to relevant resources. And if you enjoy the show, introduce a friend to the podcast and show them how you listen. Next week on the podcast, an episode with Joni Golden about her August 2021 trip to Paris. We did an itinerary review before her trip, so let's see if I led her astray or not. Send questions or feedback to annie@joinusinfrance.com. Thank you so much for listening, and I hope you join me next time so we can look around France together. Au revoir. The Join Us in France travel podcast is written, hosted, and produced by Annie Sargent, and copyright 2021 by Addicted to France. It is released under a Creative Commons Attribution, Non-Commercial, No Derivatives license.